Hey, what's up, everybody? Welcome into this Adobe Photoshop tutorial. My name is Nathaniel Dodson, and today we're going to take a look at creating this cinematic effect here in Photoshop. You see a couple examples, actually, that I've put on screen because it's an effect that works with pretty much any image. Now, depending on the type of image you input into Photoshop, it's going to affect, obviously, just how cinematic and awesome the image looks on the way out the door, but it's a very, very versatile effect. The principles stand true for pretty much any photo that you want to apply this type of effect to here in Photoshop. If you enjoy this tutorial while you're watching through it, make sure you subscribe to the channel so you don't miss any future Photoshop tutorials or retouching type tutorials. Let's jump into Photoshop right now and check this thing out. Alrighty, so here we are in Adobe Photoshop, and we've got this photo. It looks fairly cinematic at a camera, and you know, the more cinematic your photos are going to look, the more cinematic they will look after we apply this effect. But the effect should work for pretty much any photo. Alright, I'm going to right-click on this background layer, the image, and convert it to a smart object just to get us going here, because we're going to go filter and choose camera raw filter right off the bat, jump over into the camera raw editor, which is going to pop up full screen here. Well, maybe not quite full screen, I stand corrected. And the first thing I'm going to do, well, first I can try using the white balance tool and just, I don't know, selecting one of these colors. I'm really looking to just kind of cool the image off. So this kind of negative 10 temperature, plus 30 in the tint, adding a bit of magenta, that's nice. Now, this is a JPEG image that we're bringing into Camera Raw. If you're shooting with a raw image, you're probably getting an actual Kelvin readout. So generally I'm going to go with something that's more balanced against tungsten, something like 3000 or 3200. See how that's super orange? Because this is JPEG, this would actually be really blue. Like the slider would be somewhere around here for a 3,000, 3,200 Kelvin readout. I'm going to go with something that's like, I don't know, negative 10, negative 15, and just live with that. You just want it to have a slight blue tint. That's what I'm trying to say. I'm going to cool off the highlights a bit here. I'm going to set these to negative 50. I just want to tone them down a little bit because we're going to be spiking some contrast in other areas. Speaking of spiking the contrast, we're going to bump the whites about plus 25. Just gives them a kiss of strength. And we're going to lift the blacks like plus 20. Now the fun begins. We're going to go over to the tone curve, and I'm going to use the point curve. You may be seeing the parametric curve. You want to just choose the point curve like this, and I'm going to cool off the white point. So I'm going to dull the white point down to about there, and then I'm going to lift the black point to probably right about there. Then I'm going to pull a point back into play right about there. I'm just looking to just make those shadows a little heavier. Then I'm going to pull my mids back kind of into line, just click and drag and add a point there. And then I'll probably pull a little bit more brightness into my highlights, something kind of like that. Then I will come over into the red channel. Now here in the red channel, this is where we get a bit of kind of this retro-y, almost outrun looking effect. I'm going to pull straight up on the reds, right? So we're going to spike the reds in the shadows, but then I'm immediately going to pull down and contrast it with some heavy cyan also in the darker tones of the image. And then I'm going to work the cyans back kind of as smoothly as I can, sort of back to the original image. And then we're going to push additional reds into the highlights, kind of like that. And then I'm going to pull down on the brightest point of red, something like that, to add some cyan to the highlights in the image. So I'm looking for a curve kind of like this. And again, if you understand how curves works and how the histogram works and the fact that red and cyan are opposites, basically when we pull down on this curve, we're adding cyan to the image. When we pull up, we're adding red. So this area here where we're pulling down away from that original center line, we're adding cyan to that range of the image based on the histogram underneath. So a lot of the darker tones of the image, but the very darkest bits are actually getting a spike of red and so on and so forth. It kind of gives us this like pinkiness. You can see those like pink track marks almost. That's what that effect is doing. All right, we're going to move along to the green channel. I'm going to edit the green channel just a little bit here. We're going to push some green into the shadows, which again looks pretty bad, but we're going to counterbalance that by immediately pulling some magenta into here. Now, magenta is the opposite of green. You can see we're getting a crazy effect. Hang with me here. And it's really difficult, by the way. Adobe hopefully will make a more contrasting line soon. It's a little difficult to see the line, but I'm going to pull this back into line kind of like that. I'm going to adjust that point, maybe make that cyan a little bit more subtle, and maybe pull down on the base green point there so it's not totally crazy. Then I'm going to pull down on the greens up in the very highlights. Whoop, I don't want to do that. I've got a little marker up there already. You can see there it is. And I'm just going to pull this across, kind of something like that. Now, it's, again, really difficult to see the line, but you can see I just pulled down on the brightest parts of the greens, adding magenta to my very bright whites. and then adding in just a kiss of green to the highlight portion of the image, and then heavy magenta cast in the shadows, and then just a little boost of green in the absolute darkest bits of the image. So this gives us the effect that we're seeing now. Now we're going to go down to the blue channel, and here in the blue channel, obviously a little easier for us to see here, we're once again going to boost the dark point, which is going to just flood the shadows with blue tones. Again, it's a little too heavy, so we're going to pull this down. We're going to contrast this. Yellow is the opposite of blue, so we're pulling some yellow back into this thing, maybe kind of something like that, and then I'm going to try to stabilize things a little bit here, pull this point back into its normal orbit, so to speak, and we're actually going to add a little bit of blue to the highlights, something kind of like that, and then I'm just going to pull down a little bit just to warm up the absolute brightest parts of the image by adding a kiss of yellow to the very, very brightest bits of the image. And you can see what we've got. It's an interesting looking photo. It's not finished yet, though, because we're going to come over here to our HSL sliders. I'm going to begin with hue. You can try swinging the reds, and the reds are going to do things. You can see the tail light especially will get very pink or very orange, depending on what you do. I tend to like this to head more in the pink direction. I think it's more of that cool, you know, synth wave, very, very 80s type style. I think that's cool. I'm going to boost the oranges, make them a little bit more yellow, maybe like plus 10, plus 13. Yellows, I don't know that I'm going to mess with the yellows too much. Maybe just a little bit of orange for the yellows. And the greens, I'm going to push any kind of greens back toward yellow. I want a lot of those warm tones. And then for the aquas, I'm going to push them more toward the blue. And for blue, I'm going to push blue a little bit more towards purpley color. And purples, I don't think I'm going to mess with purple at all. There's not a huge amount of purple in here. I'm not going to mess with it too much. The magentas, I'm going to push more toward the red. So I'm going to push these up like plus 20-ish. These are all approximations, and they may all be different for your image. The idea is reds, we generally want them to be more pink. Oranges, yellows, greens, we want them to be more red and yellowy orange. And then all the aquas and blues and purples, we kind of want them to be a nice bluish purpley color. All right, we're going to come over here to saturation tab. And here I'm going to desaturate the reds. I'm just going to go negative 10. Oranges, I'm going to go negative 20. Yellows, I'm going to go negative 30. Greens, I'm just going to bump them like negative 20 as well. Aquas, we're going to really try to desaturate them, maybe like negative 50. Blues, we're going to really take a lot out of blue. We'll go like negative 70. Purples will go like, I don't know, negative 40 or negative 50. And then magentas will go, yeah, something like negative 20. So you can see we're really reining in the extreme color effect that we just did before. I'm going to jump into luminance here. And what we're going to do is we're going to darken down the reds just a tiny bit. We're going to boost oranges, maybe like plus 30, something like that. Yellows and greens, I'm not going to mess with them here. I'm going to just cool off my aquas a little bit, negative 20. I'm just holding down shift, by the way, and using my up and down arrow keys. I'm going to add a little bit of brightness to the blues, maybe add a little brightness to the purples, and then add a bit of brightness to magenta, maybe like plus 40, something like that, I think will work for us. Now, last but not least, here in Camera Raw, we're going to jump over here to our camera calibration, and here is where you can really determine the type of cinematic effect you're going to get. Do you want something that's more influenced by green or something that's more influenced by purple? It's a subtle change, but it is definitely a change. You can see the way it's changing kind of the colors throughout the middle of the image. I think I kind of like the purple effect, so I'm going to go like plus 40 with the purples. Now you can shift the reds. This actually makes kind of a big difference. You can see you're shifting the hue of your primary reds. I want to push these more in the direction of pink like we've been doing, so I'll go like negative 15, negative 17, that's fine. And I'm going to boost the saturation of this up, plus 25, plus 30, something like that works. Then here for greens, you can also make a big change. So again, green, but the opposite of green is magenta, so you can really start to shift the image in more of a magenta pink direction. So I'll make this like plus 40, something like that, but I think I'll just chill out the saturation a little bit, take that to about negative 10, something like that I think works for me. Then for blue primary, you can see we can make things more yellow or make things more reddy, pinky blue by adding blue. So I'm going to shift it more toward the teal end of my blue primaries, just like that, about negative 15 or so. And I'll just kind of cool down the saturation of that as well. And you can see we're getting this very cool looking effect. So I'm going to hit OK. And part of the reason that we used Camera Raw was, well, by the way, we can shut off the filter. There was our original image and there's what we've done to it. But we could also double click here on Camera Raw and get back in and continue editing it if we needed to do that. All right, I'm going to add a selective color adjustment layer here. And I'm going to come down to the blacks. And with the blacks, I'm going to try to lift the blacks a little bit. You can see what that's going to do. It's actually going to give us some nice, really tight, low-end contrast. I'm going to go like plus 5. But what I'm also going to do, I'm going to boost the magenta a little bit. I'm just going to use my arrow keys. I'm going to add a couple drips of magenta to the shadows. And then down here, remember, blue is the opposite of yellow. So if I remove some yellow, I'm going to get a little bit blue. So I'm just going to add just a couple little drips of blue. I don't want to go too extreme. You can see just one little effect is making quite a bit of difference there for us. Then I think I'm going to come into here here, and I'm going to go to the whites, and I'm going to boost the red. So red's the opposite of cyan, so I'm going to add some red to the absolute highlights. Maybe I'll add a little magenta up there as well. Ooh, not too much, just a couple drips of magenta. And then I'll also add some yellow up there. The general idea behind like cinematic grading is you're, in general, going to be contrasting opposite colors in the shadows and highlights. It's part of the reason why you see a lot of this kind of blue in the shadows, yellow in the highlights thing when you're looking at cinematic grading, because blue and yellow are opposite colors. Enough banter. Let's create a new layer here. I'm going to name this layer Flares. And what we're going to do is set this layer to the blend mode of Color Dodge. I'm going to double click on the layer, just the blank area out here, and I'm going to shut off Transparency Shapes Layer. So I'm going to click on that to shut it off, hit OK. And then I'm going to grab my brush tool. Now, I'm going to right click here, and you might want to go online, brusheasy.com, wherever you find flare brushes, and just find, you know, some nice flare brushes. You can see we've got some flare brushes here. What I want to do is hold down my Alt or Option key and sample, so I can sample like a nice pink color, and then I can begin adding and influencing the pink here in the tail light, for instance. I'm going to make just a giant flare. This is almost 5,000 pixels, this brush. Something like that looks cool. Maybe add a little bit down here. I can add a little bit off in the distance and over here. Then I can go and get some of this kind of greenish color, and I can really just add a little bit of that light coming through there. We can get like a little bit of this light blue, steely blue color and add some kind of something there on the exhaust. That looks cool. And you can just go through, maybe add a little bit over here in terms of yellow over there. So it's just a little effect along the way, but you can see it just makes a little bit of a difference there when you're adding some flares, layer on some of the effect that we're working with. Now we can merge all these layers to a new layer by hitting Command-Shift-Option-E. That would be Control-Shift-Alt-E on the PC. And I am going to, well, I'll convert this to a smart object first and foremost. I'm going to double click and I'm going to name this Blur. And before we blur it, we're going to go Filter. I'm going to choose Pixelate and I'm going to choose Mosaic. And I want to just choose kind of a big mosaic. Something like 150 actually might work for the size image I have. You might need to go a little bit bigger or smaller depending on how big or small your image is. I'm going to go 500. I'm going to hit OK. And then we'll go Filter Blur and I'm going to choose a Motion Blur. Move the motion blur dialog box out here. I do want to blur this straight up and down. A distance of 400 to 500 is going to work just fine. Maybe we'll go, let me see what 400 looks like. I really want to make sure I'm not losing too much of the pinks and blues and some of those colors. I don't want it all to blend together. I think 400 works nicely. I'm going to hit OK. Then I'm going to set this layer to the blend mode of soft light. Now, this adds kind of this racing-looking effect, especially around the lights. It adds this very almost 8-bit effect, which is kind of cool. However, it's too much. It's darkening everything way too much. So we want to double-click out here on the blank area of this layer. We're back into our Layer Styles dialog box. And what I want to do is split the black handle here under the Blend If options for this layer. So I'm going to hold down Alt or Option, click on that handle, and then I'm just going to drag this over. And I really just want to pull kind of this effect out of all the darker areas of this layer. You can see how we still have the kind of up and down stripey effect happening around all the bright areas of this layer. That's fine. I just don't want it doing too much in the shadows. See, there's before, there's after. So we're just brightening everything up a little bit. I'm going to hit OK for that. And then the last thing we'll do here in order to add a little bit more mid-tone punch is merge all those layers to a new layer. Again, Command-Shift-Option-E, Control-Shift-Alt-E on the PC. Then we'll desaturate this layer, Command-Shift-U, that would be Control-Shift-U on the PC. We'll go Filter, we'll choose Other, and we'll choose High Pass. And I'm going to go with, yeah, something like 15 pixels, 10 or 15 pixels. High Pass is going to be great. I'll go 10 pixels in this case. And I'm going to set this to Soft Light. And then I'm just going to reduce the opacity maybe to like, I don't know, 45 or 50, something right around there. We're just looking to add a little bit of bite to the image. It's a subtle effect, but it's definitely there. And then the last thing we need to do is add our sort of cinematic bars to this. Now, the cinematic ratio that I like is 2:3:9:1. So I'm going to add a shape like that. And what I'm going to use to create my crop is the rectangle tool. It's kind of a cool little effect or way we're going to do this. However, I want this to snap exactly to my document. So we can go view, make sure snapping is turned on, but you're going to see here that as I draw this, it's not going to snap to the edges of my document. I'm going to undo that. And I'm going to come up here to the view menu and we're going to choose a new guide layout. And I'm just going to go with kind of the default here, 2 and 2, 2 columns, 2 rows. I don't need a margin. I'm going to shut that off and I'm going to hit OK. The nice thing about these guides is our shape will snap to the guides. Now, this is not it. We want to come up here to the cog menu and we want to choose to make this a proportional shape. And you can see here, I want to set this to a width of 2:3:9 and a height of 1. That's the ratio that we want. So now I can just simply click and I can drag it across my document. It's going to snap to my guides just like that. And I made a mistake here because I don't want to draw a path. I want to actually draw a shape. So from the little drop-down menu, I'm going to choose shape. This is all good, right? We'll make sure that we're still going proportional 2, 3, 9 to 1. Great. I don't need a stroke. I do want a fill. In fact, we'll change the fill to black because that's just what's going to work for us. And I'm going to drag this shape out now. And there we go. But you can see here, we're getting everything except the bars that we want. Don't worry, we're going to fix that here in just a second. Let's align this to the middle of our document. So I'm going to come up here and choose my alignment. I'm going to say, look, align to the canvas, and then align the vertical edges. Great. And I'm going to open up my properties panel. And here, I'm going to change this to the subtract or minus front shape option here. And when I do that, you can see that I'm going to get this nice automatically created cinematic bar effect. Really cool. I can go view. I can just shut off the guides. And if I deselect my cinematic bars, you can see what it looks like. Now, the advantage to this is if we group everything underneath this, so if I select my high pass layer, hold down shift, select my bottom layer, hit Command or Control G, and we can just name this image or whatever, then I can drag this and create the crop that I want. So I can say, you know what, I want to see the top of his helmet right up there near the top of the frame, and there we go. We have our cinematic image, cinematic effect, cinematic bars, cinematic stinking everything. In fact, I'm going to duplicate this effect back here, and I am going to set it back to the way it was. Let's do a quick before and after. I'm going to set this up here. I'm just going to shut off my smart filters, and all I need to do is Alt or Option, click on this eyeball. There's the image before, and there is the image now. And yeah, there you have it. That is that cinematic effect. We kind of made it a little bit more outrunny maybe there at the end with the flares and the color scheme we ended up going with, but the principles remain the same when it comes to applying a cinematic effect to a photo. A lot of those principles stand true no matter what the image is that you bring into Photoshop. Now, if you did enjoy the tutorial, make sure you, well, pick up a copy of my course. That's what I'm trying to say. Pick up a copy of my course. It helps support the channel and what we're doing here. And it's all about retouching images in Photoshop. So I think you're really going to like it for working with Camera Raw and the different adjustment layers and the whole red and cyan, green, magenta, blue, yellow, opposite color, curve nonsense that we covered to create this very cinematic looking photo here in Adobe Photoshop. Ladies and gentlemen, that's it. Get it, got it, good. Nathaniel Dodson, tutvid.com. I'll catch you in the next one. And before you go, make sure you subscribe to my channel for more great tutorials every day. Also, buy my course. It helps us do what we do, and this channel is supported by viewers just like you. You can also just click the thumbnail and watch another video from this channel. See you next time, guys.